Yeah, well, as far as I think that comes from Hilarion, and it's true as far as I can see. I mean, the face is a map of the seven chakras, no doubt, from chin to forehead or third eye, one to six, and the three zones of the face basically are body, mind, spirit, and the body basically is mouth, particularly lower lip down to chin and the jawline in a horizontal line. The mind complex zone is the midline of the mouth up to the eyebrows, and the spirit complex is the forehead. And so the condition of a forehead indicates the condition of six and seven chakra development or integration. The condition of what? Eyebrows, eyes, ears, nose, upper lip, cheeks, jawbone, cheekbone. It represents conditions of chakras 2, 3, 4, 5, which is mainly which is the heart of the mind complex. And then particularly below below the midline of the mouth, the chin, below the lower lip to the chin, and as a horizontal line to the jaw is body complex. So thick eyebrows indicates a significant curtain or barrier between the mind complex, eyes and down, and the spirit complex forehead, which means a strong attachment to materiality, material sensual pleasure. Meanwhile, there are some great teachers who have that, and that's not a problem necessarily. So, meaning, it's very helpful for some souls that are highly spiritually developed to have a pretty anchored or solid material basis, to be sort of sensual within limits as an anchoring to a soul that an otherwise wouldn't be on Earth. So there are certain great teachers who have thicker eyebrows. It's not unusual, but the person who has a lot of, who's, you see, you have to understand, all these people want social acclaim. They all want social recognition. That's why they're in society rather than out of it. They're in society doing what they're doing because getting social approval and acclaim and recognition is part of what they want. And the ones who don't want it are not there. Got it? They're there because they have some attachment to being to name and fame, to fame and gain, and being seen and being appreciated, and being important people in the world. All of them. And I, could have gone that way, but I have to make compromises. I have, what I do is not going to be appealing to many. Because it's more subtle or what? Advanced or difficult to figure out, and I'm not trying to make it easy. I'm not trying to make it hard, but I'm not trying to make it easy. And these people, they are worldly, more or less, okay? And they say they want to help people, and they do want to help people. They are also helping themselves. And so one has to just take a hard look at their level of commitment to truth. And it's just the way of consensus, collective humanity, collective consciousness, really, that speak too much truth and you will lose your audience. Ask your audience to think too deeply, you will lose them. Don't try to make them happy and make them feel good about themselves, they will leave you. Don't try to give them something they like, true or not. And they'll go to somebody who does. And so, these are called the worldly people. And maybe that's harsh, and I'm not saying I'm any better, but for me, I mean, I'm just looking at them in relation to how I went my own path so I can help, help myself figure out what's going on here in this with all these different people. There definitely are sincere people who are big shots. But there is a real problem, or is a conflict between an unconditional commitment to truth and speaking truth and going deeper and going ever deeper and presenting that freely in a non-diluted form, trusting that the audience who can get it will get it, and those that want to go far, yes, we can go far, but I'm not going to give you pablum, or I'm not going to basically just keep going, you know, in the shallows. Let's go to the depths. There's a conflict between being that way and remaining popular and relevant to lots of people. It just doesn't go together. Yeah, I'm just saying, first of all, I think you're absolutely right that the intuitive feel when you meet a person, particularly a person that speaks about spirituality, is a fine guide to getting a sense of the level of development or the maturity of that person. I mean, I trust that. I'm not right about everything, but I trust, in general, those direct perceptions. You know, it's okay to say I'm not sure. I can be absolutely sure that I'm not sure. That's not a problem. You know? You can be absolutely certain that you're not yet certain. And that means I have a feeling this is the case, but I'm not absolutely sure. But until I'm more sure, I'll go with my current, you know, assessment of the situation. Well, that's why it was surprising, because I had an expectation, but I didn't have a hope. Big difference. I didn't hope he was what I wanted him to be. I expected him to be what I thought he probably was, but he wasn't. And so hope and expectation are different and should be delineated, ought to be. It's okay to, I mean, I hope, I would like everybody in the world to like me. I'd like to find my perfect soulmate, or many perfect soulmates, or live in a beautiful, wonderful, loving community where everybody's mature and everybody helps everybody and everybody's, you know, very filled with love light. But I don't expect it on this planet. Fine. I expect it after I die or when I go home, but I don't expect it here. But I know the difference between hope and expectation. So I didn't have any emotional need to put into some category. You see, I've seen awakened teachers. I've seen guys who are finished or nearly finished. I've seen pictures and I've met some. And that's the real deal. And that's all totally subjective, unprovable. But I trust those perceptions. And I compare everybody to that and try to, you know, that's why I don't talk about myself very much. Because it's just another person. I'm just another guy on the path like you. And even the great ones, way above Steiner. Steiner was, you know, Steiner had teachers, and Steiner was not living higher self. Okay? Steiner was a senior disciple. A senior, you know, he was probably an adept, but he's, you know, a senior disciple to the level of Atman. He's not living Atman. But there are some people who are living Atman here, and they're not public. And they're very few. And they're not public. And so, guys, you know, historical monks that I would say are finished. Absolutely finished. Nityananda, of the real Nityananda of Ganesh Puri, or from the south, is finished. And in Thailand, I met some people. I've seen, you know, I mean, I've met Trungpa Rinpoche. I've met Dilgo Khyentse Rinpoche. I've met Kalu Rinpoche. I met Bhikkhu Bodhi from the Theravadan tradition. I've met Zen master, you know, and then unnamed people who I don't even know who their names are, as well as have out-of-body experiences with beings who are finished or nearly finished. as well as seeing pictures of historical figures, particularly Thai tradition, Thai forest tradition guys. I could show you pictures online. I could give you, you know, I could show you a page and you can find all their pictures. And those guys are, they know about extraterrestrials. They don't care because extraterrestrials are not finished either. They're just senior students too. And so we're talking about the eternal path of transformation, or, you know, the spiritual path, which we're all on, and we're all doing the same work, ultimately, which is, you know, what? Mind, body, spirit, perfection, seven chakra perfection, complete and perfect enlightenment goal. And the people who are further along have withdrawn from major public positions, generally. In the past, there were some, but they're right at the edge, because they don't want it. It's like Rajneesh, right, Osho, who had a dozen or two dozen Rolls Royces, right, because people gave it to him. And his explanation is, well, one can be Zorba the Buddha, you know, lusty and sensual as well as wise and free. Well, no, actually, that's not true. The people who are seeking complete and perfect awakening don't want all that stuff. Everything, mm-hmm. all the money and the food and the offerings given to Nityananda, he gave it back to the community immediately. He didn't hold it. He gave it. You don't want it. I don't want that. It ain't nothing to me. Like that. Yeah, well, it's a different time than past centuries, culture, consciousness, and religious leadership. Today, evil is in control of all the major religions, basically. I mean, in general, there's a lot of negativity in religion, East and West, particularly West. But in the past, it was similar, but not as intense, the negativity, and dotted throughout the centuries were really achieved beings here and there, in both East and West. I mean, Saint Francis of Assisi, or certain Christian monks or Christians, they were very high souls. Same thing with some Islamic sheikhs, or whatever they would be called, you know, teachers, here and there, you know, here and there. Same thing with Buddhist and Hindu. Every century, the 20th century had a number, you know. I mean, in India, other than Nityananda, you have what's his name? The guy who did the teachings on Who Am I? Ramana Maharshi. Ramana Maharshi was finished, it seems. Even the original Sai Baba, not the curly hair Sai Baba, but the guy before him, was considered finished and seemed to be. And then Thai forest tradition, and you had, you know, a couple of guys in Japan and China for sure in the 20th century. Now it's finished, it seems. And there's, you know, there was more of a top-heavy situation before, where you'd have a few, you'd have really awakened teachers in various religions and traditions, a couple or three or four or five in a century, and most everybody else doesn't know much. Today, you don't have that, but you have more people trying to talk about fourth chakra consciousness, which is good. So the middle has been filled out, rather than the extremes of those, the very, very few that are really clear and finished. And most everybody else, not really understanding the middle ground of love, wisdom, but seeking awakening and not really being able to hit that, and being sort of dumb layman. Today, the quality of consciousness of the non-monastics is higher, while the quality of the monastics is lower. So, meaning, there really aren't that many. I've not seen publicly teachers of the magnitude that I would refer to as great beings. But the mass, the level of consciousness of the mass of seekers is higher, meaning more people are centered in appreciation of love, wisdom than before. But those that would be considered finished are fewer than before, or at least they've withdrawn from the public arena. So you know, long before there was YouTube, I was looking into these things in the '80s, in the late '70s and the '80s, and could see those that are way up above me, you know, the real highbrows, and that's how I measure. So it doesn't impress me if somebody has 50,000 subscribers. It doesn't mean anything. I mean, Eminem and Madonna have 10 million subscribers. So numbers don't mean that. You know, numbers don't indicate a level of development of the teacher or the source. But in general, if you want, the people who are popular have to keep themselves popular and relevant. You know, you have to really, you have to say what you've been saying again and again, actually, and you have to make it easy and pleasant and happy, give people a happy feeling, and be entertaining, actually. And that's very awful. Yeah, I'm not so familiar with, I never went into those guys like Alan Watts and D.T. Suzuki. I went much further earlier. I mean, I went to the sources that they were drawing from, like the blue, you know, the Blue Cliff Record translation of koans from China, you know, 1,000 years ago. Right. I was reading Arthur Whaley when I was 16, and you know, very fine translations of the Dhammapada in high school, in late high school, and then I was reading Polytext Society, you know, Rise Davids, if you know who that is, R-H-Y-S, you know, Sir Rise Davids, you know, Victorian, late 19th century, kind of poor but helpful initial translations of Pali PTS, Polytech Society, old translations of the original from 2,500 years ago in high school, or, you know, in my 20s, early 20s. And I knew from that time those, you know, what they're pointing towards, that's the goal. Guys who are really free. And that's why I never stayed with any one teacher, because all the teachers that I met were disappointing to me. Edo Roshi in upstate New York, Sung San Sanim, the Korean Zen master in Providence, Rhode Island, even Ajahn Chah in Thailand I met. I don't know if I met him, he was sick, but I went to his monastery. And they didn't want me there, maybe because he was sick, or they knew I wouldn't fit there, and that was right, so I went to the south. And I met Ajahn Buddhadasa, who is another guy who's pretty much finished, at least third stage awakening. Buddhadasa, D-H, you can see pictures of him, Buddhadasa, B-U-D-D-H-A, and something, D-A-S-A maybe. But definitely, he was the real thing. But Trungpa Rinpoche, you know, was kind of a mess. And Kalu Rinpoche seemed to be very fully, seemed to be quite awakened, K-A-L-U. But you have to join up with the whole situation if you want to be in the Tibetan Buddhist situation, Buddhist groups now. And there's a whole lot of stuff that doesn't interest me a lot in the Tibetan sanghas, Tibetan Buddhist sanghas. So I just went my own way every time, year after year, and kept seeking, and then I hit the raw material, and then, you know, in 87, and so that's 30 years ago, and never looked back from that, because it actually resonated with my understanding of core principles, metaphysics of Buddhism and Hinduism, perfectly, with no problem whatsoever. And basically, you know, like you can get a sense of somebody's level of development from their aura, from their energy field when you meet them. Likewise, one can get that from a photograph of a face, of a being, or a person. Likewise, one can get that from reading a book and feeling the vibration of the voice, of the words, of the mind that made the words, of the mind, the quality of the words reflect the maturity of the mind, obviously. And so the vibratory quality of the words shows you the level of development of the mind. And the raw material, you know, was head and shoulders above everything else that I've read in terms of channeling. It was not head and shoulders above Gautama, but it was head and shoulders Tao Te Ching or Lao Tzu or Zhang Tzu, or Dhammapada. But it was head and shoulders above everything else that was modern. And that's why I stayed with it, because the deeper I went, the more I got from it. And that's actually how you know you've got a good practice or a good teaching source, which is the more you use it, the more you get from it. Every time I read the raw material, or every time I looked into it, I learned more and got spiritual nourishment or uplift or clarity. So I got into it. So Hermes Trismegistus means, Trismegus, triple magus, triply magnified, triply what? Completed? What is a magus? The magus is, I did a little talk on this. There's a connection between magus and magnification. And the magus is the one who has perfect magnification of seeing, you know, basically unlimited perception. The doors of perception cleansed, right? Seeing reality as it is, infinite, as Blake said. So that's triply honored or triply completed, as the magus it would be. I looked into it a little, but it just seemed a little too puffy, a little bit too kind of, the language didn't appeal to me. It's a little bit like the Urantia book. So I'm sure there are fine principles in there, and actually somebody just referred me to some guy who's talking on that, William Bill Carson, black guy, definitely a wanderer, talking about the Emerald Tablets. And I'm sure there's some fine wisdom in there. It, however, may be a modern concoction. I would not assume it's like, 20,000 years old or something? I wouldn't assume that. Because people are, believe it or not, there are lots of spiritual, you know, liars. And so, even if it's 80% good wisdom, which I'll acknowledge, somebody could say this is found 20,000 years ago, but it's not. It was written by them or somebody else. So, but it seemed all right to me. How about, what's your sense of that? And those people had, you know, that's their understanding of doing good. That if I say this is channeled or 20,000 years old, like the Emerald Tablets or something, more people will listen. And even though that's not true, I know they would say that what I'm offering is good and important and helpful. Therefore, it's a little trick to get the children to pay attention. Which, you know, some people believe that. And I wouldn't do that. But in a sense, if you could put aside for the moment authorship or origin, those questions of authorship and origin, just look at the look at the facts and look at the statements being made. And there's definitely important wisdom there. But if you know the raw material really well, like I hope to, what I've found is that most other sources fall away really fast because they're trying to say what Ra said, but they don't know enough to say it that directly. What they're saying is what Ra said in far fewer words with much greater specificity. You know, like God is love. Well, that's cute, but actually God is infinity. But the substance of light is love, Ra said. Intelligent energy, which gave rise to the seven dimensions or seven rays, the nature of that light is love. And then Ra even explains the origin of that light, which is the action of free will upon love, which is the action of infinite will, omnipotence, on infinite love, which is actually omniscience, which is first and second principles, as Ra said, giving rise to the third principle, law of light. So, law of free will, law of love, law of light. That's the, that's the basis of, that's the basic process by which creation came to be. The action of infinite will on infinite love or mind, enabling the manifestation of infinite light, which is intelligent energy, which is called love, light, light, love. While it's light, its nature is love. That's the basis of the saying God is love. Because, you know, the nature of creation is light, which is energy prior to free, to vibration. Right, the nature of God power, which gave rise to vibration, that's called intelligent energy, but its nature is love, but it came out by infinite will, and so it's not enough to say God is love, but to the extent that all creation is light, whose nature is love, you can say God is love. That's what they mean to say, but they can't say it, because they don't know enough, as far as I can tell. So thank you, everybody. Good to be together again. See you next time, and good night.